Steve, despite the long shadow cast by 14,000-foot-tall Pikes Peak, it's a boiler here inside Pikes Peak International Raceway today. Over 100 degrees air temperature. Right now getting set for Busch Pole qualifying for the NASCAR Busch Series. 47 drivers to race the clock for 43 starting spots in tomorrow's 250-mile race. Alan Best with Wally Dallenbach here to bring you Busch Pole qualifying. And Wally, this racetrack, it's fast, but it's going to be a handful for these drivers today.
Yeah, we have all kinds of things. We have a track temperature that's just blistering today. This racetrack, all the drivers mentioned two racetracks when they talk about this place, Darlington and Rockingham. There's just no grip. And a lot of that has to do with, well, we're up above 5,000 feet. There's nowhere to push these cars into the racetrack. So, yeah, they're going to have their hands full.
Here is a name you haven't heard in the NASCAR Busch Series since the Mexico City race in early March. This is Jorge Getters. Remember, he's the driver that went out and won the pole for that race on the road course in Mexico City, and then led the first 24 laps or so, ended up falling out with an engine failure late in the day, but going to make an oval track start here. Talked with Jorge this morning, Wally. He said this is not his first oval track race. He ran some Indy Lights races back in 1998. But this is a whole different thing.
He hasn't done it in one of these tubs. And this is a tough place to cut your teeth, too, in one of these cars. Because, like I said, this racetrack doesn't have a lot of grip right now. 130-plus track temperature. You're going to be sliding around a lot.
27.861 was the first lap time for Getters. This car does have owner's points. This is the Braun Racing machine that Shane Meal started the season in. Jason Leffler has been driving in recent weeks. And so they will be in the race. The Getter's looking to get all he can here for a starting position. Fast time in practice was 27 flat, 27.034. Second lap, a little bit slower for Getters. So a 27.86 for our first qualifier. And we go down to pit road. Here's Dave Burns.
The last time Hank Parker was in the 60 car, it was to race it after Carl Edwards had qualified it at Nashville. Today, Hank Parker qualifies it so that Carl Edwards can make his way back from Pocono and race it here. But you didn't spend any time on the track in the second practice session. Why not?
Well, there's guys that are behind the scenes, just like there's guys behind the scenes for you that can see the whole picture. You know, Shifty's telling you what to do. Brad Parrott's got the reins on me pretty tight right here. Got a great Charter Communications Ford. And, you know, we just ran through some things first thing this morning in practice. Really didn't bust off a great lap this morning when it was cool, when a lot of guys did, but we were good in race trim. So we had just elected not to run that second practice. Gives us some extra tires and maybe an advantage in the race.
All right, Hank Parker scheduled to go out ninth.
I'd like to correct Hank on that. You know, it's not just Shifty who tells Dave what to. It's all of us.
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, I live with that daily. That is my life, isn't it, Wally?
Yes, it is. Yeah. I just wanted to point that out.
I appreciate it.
They say it's good to give Shifty a shout-out.
Oh, here we go. Let's not get the producer's head going all blown up here in the early going. Reed Sorensen on track now. Just set fast time, 27.663. Sorensen third fastest in practice in his first ever trip here to Pikes Peak International Raceway. Didn't come out to test. First laps he ever drove on it this morning.
Sometimes that's good. Sometimes that's good. Yeah, because you can come here and the track can be totally different than when you came and tested here. So
a little bit slower on the second lap. Trend we expect to continue throughout Busch Pole qualifying, but Sorensen in with the early lead in qualifying here at Pikes Peak International Raceway. Two of 47 cars have made their runs. John Wood on the track when we come back on Speed. Speed Channel's coverage of NASCAR Busch Series qualifying from the Pikes Peak International Raceway brought to you by the U.S. Navy. Navy, accelerate your life. John Wood on the track now. In Busch Pole qualifying, Stuart, Virginia, looking to see if he can squeeze a good starting spot out. John was 23rd fastest in practice.
This time, so far, he's at the top.
He just bumped Reed Sorensen back off the number one spot. Wonder if this racetrack is going to be like, you know, Loudon and some others, Wally, where when it sits in the sun for a while, and this track sat in the sun for a couple hours between the end of the last activity and the start of qualifying, if the first few guys that ran are going to be at a time disadvantage.
I would say yes. I think that's like that just about anywhere you go that you have. What's it was like 4 hours or something like that
from the last Busch Series practice. Yeah.
So
27.63.
I think it'll get a little bit quicker, but yeah, I mean, Reed Sorensen, he should be still at the top of the list based on practice.
And we welcome to our Bush Pole qualifying coverage Lindsay Zarniak, who's going to cover the pits for us in the garage today. Lindsay, go ahead.
Thanks, guys. We just woke up Martin Truex Jr. He was in there taking a big old nap because he doesn't qualify until the 40th spot. But Martin, how much of an advantage do you feel that spot is for you?
Well, I think it's going to be a little bit. Hopefully it cools off for us. I know going out the first 10 or 15 cars is probably really bad because of the rubber from the other series that was out there. So it's just going to be an advantage in two ways. Hopefully it cools off for us and we'll be able to get a good lap in. But our best Pro Chevrolet was decent in practice. We were kind of all over the board, a little too loose, a little too tight at the end. And went somewhere in the middle. Hopefully it'll be good.
Martin, this time last year you had 5 poles already. This season you don't have one yet. Do you feel like the car is good enough to get you there today?
Well, I don't know. To be honest with you, the impound rules really affect our qualifying. Usually if we qualify good, we don't run good. So we seem like when we run good, we're anywhere from 15th to 20th. So hopefully today we can get inside the top 10 and have a good run tomorrow also.
Martin Truex hot off a win in New Hampshire, guys.
All right, Lindsay, thanks. Here is David Stremme, qualified third for this race a year ago. First lap was fastest. That trend, here we go, as the more laps get put on the racetrack, Wally. And for Stremme, second lap going to be just a touch slower. So 27.319. And that is a fast lap so far in our Bush Pole qualifying session for David Stremme. And we say hello from Pikes Peak International Raceway. Alan Bestwick, Wally Dallenbach, bringing you Bush Pole qualifying. And Wally, this racetrack for drivers who have never been here before, and there are quite a few in this field as the series only runs here once a year. Getting to learn a place that you really don't come to test at because it's so far away from the Charlotte base for these teams. How difficult is it for these guys to learn a new racetrack and then have to go out and slam a qualifying lap in?
Well, I think the track is pretty easy to learn. It's not a real difficult racetrack. It's pretty easy as far as driving it, but it's just no grip. So the guys that haven't run here, haven't really experienced a car that slides around a lot, it's tough to come here for the first time. And then you've got the pressure of qualifying. You know, with the impound rule the way it is, you've got to get your car driving good so it feels good in the race and yet be quick enough, you know, to qualify. So it is hard for guys that haven't seen this place before.
David Green has seen the place before. On track now, has just set fast time on his first lap.
And David was pretty quick in practice.
Yeah.
This morning. So we figured he'd have a strong run today.
27.217 for David on his first lap. Second lap to be a little slower.
And that's actually pretty good. I mean, considering that's only a couple tenths slower than what they ran this morning, I thought the track would be slower than that, as hot as it is right now.
So there's your new leader in the Bush Pole qualifying, David Green, to the top of the stack. And David's best previous start here was seventh, and he's got to finish as high as second at this racetrack. I talked with David earlier today. Felt pretty good about their chances to have a good run and maybe pick up a win on Saturday afternoon.
Here's another guy that's feeling pretty good.
Yeah, Tyler Walker. And he's feeling pretty good because
he's on the top of the final practice speed charts. Now he ran a 27.034.
And he just gave the wall a good scare out of a turn two. When the shadow between the car and the wall disappears completely, you're probably a little close to it.
That's when you close your right eye and you grit your right side of your mouth. Waiting for the hit.
Yeah. Let's see what he did. Lap one, Tyler is going to be second fastest, 27.270.
And that slip up there was all it took to prevent him from being fast time.
One and done. Given what we'll see out of the tires here, I wouldn't be surprised to see a lot of guys give up on the second lap if they thought the first one stuck pretty well. Dave, who are you talking to?
Talking to Justin Labonte right now, who's got a new crew chief on board this week. How much confidence has Harold Holly built into you?
Well, he's brought a lot of confidence and just really helped our whole team. And we're excited, you know, about the rest of the season. I think it might take us a couple weeks to really get going good, but he's got a lot of great ideas. And I think we'll have a good second half of the season.
Looking forward for these guys, it does look very promising, guys.
Yeah, that's not only confidence for the drivers, confidence for the whole team. When a guy like Harold comes in and brings some new ideas and things like that, it's a good feeling.
And a pretty well proven track record of speed in this NASCAR Busch Series, too. Here is Brandon Miller,
The 23-year-old from Bakersfield, California, splitting time in this car for Richard Childress Racing with Kevin Harvick this year. And doing the driver development plan, and he's in this car for the next 3 weeks here, then on to St. Louis next week, and Indianapolis Raceway Park the week after. 18th fastest in practice this morning. And fourth quick on his first lap.
Ooh, and that's going to be it. Because that car, well, he's still going. He left about 0.4 of a second over there between one and two.
He hit that patch over there and it kind of jumped around. But he's going to finish it up anyway. So that'll be fourth fastest. Ricky Byers, crew chief for this team, told me this morning they actually knocked off their race practice early to focus on some qualifying runs because they felt like with the impound situation, ignoring that with a young driver like Brandon, they were leaving him too far back in traffic to start the race and putting him in situations maybe they didn't need to.
Right.
All right, David Stremme qualified a couple minutes ago. Lindsay's with him.
David, right now currently holding the third spot. How was your lap out there?
It wasn't too bad considering we went out pretty early. Reed and I were talking that the support series they have running here run the bias tires and seems to hurt us everywhere we go. So a lot of guys will get faster as the night goes on or as it goes into evening. But all this is a starting spot. We got a good race car for tomorrow, so I'm pretty happy.
Guys?
David Stremme third right now behind David Green and Tyler Walker, and here's Hank Parker Jr. Now, if you recall this race 1 year ago, this race car started last with Greg Biffle on board, and it is this race car, and Biffle went on to win the race. So Carl Edwards is going to come in here tomorrow and get in this race car, and because Hank's doing the qualifying while Carl's at Pocono today, he's going to have to start last, Carl will, and hopes for the same outcome. Start last anyway. You heard Hank kind of say they've got the reins on him. There's no sense in hanging it out there and taking a chance on backing it into the fence on the qualifying lap.
Yeah, just exactly. Put a lap in. I mean, Hank practiced the car and hopefully got the car to where Carl likes it. But yeah, it doesn't matter.
And they ran the slowest lap time that has been posted so far. 9th out of 9 and a 28-18 for Hank Parker Jr. And again, Carl Edwards in that car tomorrow starting at the back of the field. Here is Tim Fedewa. Qualified third here a couple of times. And best finish of second, 1999 race. Tim to make his 70th consecutive NASCAR Busch Series start tomorrow. Watch that patch right there in the middle of the corner.
Yeah, it's a handful for a lot of these cars. Some of the cars are going over real well. Got good shots underneath them, but some of those guys are hitting that patch and it's definitely upsetting the car.
Tim kind of had a rough weekend in New Hampshire last Saturday, huh?
And everybody around him.
And crew chief change on this team. Mike Ricci resigning stepping away on Monday. And their team's competition director, Scott Eggleston, going to oversee operations of Tim Fedewa's effort here until they name a permanent crew chief. Fifth fastest on the first lap for Timmy, 27:41. Was 14th fastest in practice earlier today at a 27:27.
Yeah, it looks like a lot of the guys are running about 0.2 of a second slower than what they practiced.
And second lap to be slower. So fifth fastest out of 10 for Tim Fedewa. Young man who almost got his first NASCAR Busch Series win last weekend with Dave.
And that is Denny Hamlin. Denny, after the third place finish at Loudon last week, does that make coming to a new place like this any easier with a little momentum?
Yeah, I definitely think we got momentum on our side. Seems like these flat mile racetracks is where we have our strong points, and got the same type of setup, a little different race car, but we were pretty good. We were like fifth fastest before everybody started the qualifying runs, and we weren't all that great in qualifying trim, but hopefully we'll be able to pick it up, get a good top 10 starting spot. And looking forward to this. Rockwell Automation Chevrolet is great, so definitely looking forward to the race.
Okay, Denny getting ready to go out and get his laps in, Alan.
Well, Kenny looks like he's on a pretty decent lap right there.
Kenny Wallace.
Got through one or two good.
2001 pole winner here at Pikes Peak. Survey says second fastest. 27:233 for Kenny.
Kenny, of course, his team and their sponsor, Parting Company, a couple of weeks ago. You see the predominantly white car for Wallace this weekend, trying to put some things together from race to race to get him through the rest of the season and find some backing for beyond this year. And the second lap a little bit slower for Kenny, so second fastest so far for Kenny Wallace. And the man who has run faster than Kenny, well, he's with Lindsay.
That's right. David Green holds the pole. David, I realize you guys had to go through quite an ordeal to get that car ready.
Yeah, we did. We ran this car at Loudon last week and got it tore up pretty good. But Stuart Cooper, my crew chief, and all my Kleenex guys did a great job turning this car around. And I got to say hi to John Cook and everyone at Kimberly Clark for supporting us week in and week out. We've had a tough year. But I can see light at the end of the tunnel, and it's that kind of dedication that my crew has. Along with my dedication to win in this 27 Kleenex Ford, that hopefully today we can get our first pole.
David Green leading after 10 of the 47 cars have run. Here's Justin Labonte on track. Justin in practice was 24th fastest. We talked with him just a few minutes ago about the new crew chief signing on with the Coast Guard team this week, Harold Holly.
You can see the cars that get through one and two good. They stay a little bit lower in the racetrack, and they really, you can see the cars gripping. Just in that time, just as he got to right before the center of the corner, looked like his car slid up the racetrack. So he's having a hard time getting some grip.
27:43 on his first lap, seventh fastest for Justin. He's had a couple of tough weeks, been swept up in some wrecks the last 3 weeks, basically, straight. And could use a good run here on Saturday to get things turned around. Seventh overall for Justin Labonte as we're early in the going in Busch Pole qualifying from Pikes Peak International Raceway in Colorado Springs. Coming back with more after this. Tonight on Speed, we'll take you back to Pocono Raceway in Pennsylvania for Nextel Cup final practice. Drivers work their way around the fast three-cornered, two-and-a-half-mile track, getting ready for tomorrow's Butt Bowl qualifying. 9 Eastern tonight, Nextel Cup final practice on Speed. And here at Pikes Peak, it's Busch Pole qualifying ongoing. Here's Denny Hamlin on track. Talked to him a minute ago, trying to make his first start here at Pikes Peak.
Denny was, what, 22nd fastest on that last practice.
And he is fourth fastest on that first lap. 27:27 for Hamlin, and it's going to be one and done for him.
Yeah,
I think unless you screw up on the first lap's going to be it.
Yeah.
You know, really run that second lap if you mess up on the first lap.
It's mentioned that Brad Teague and Clint Vacholtz have made their qualifying runs while we were in a break. Teague 12th fastest and Vacholtz 13th. Those two drivers not guaranteed spots in the field. Dave?
Rolling up the qualifying line with Stacy Compton. Stacy, a great finish here last year of second. You kind of strategized on him. What kind of a race car do you have this year for qualifying?
We got just as good a race car. Kingsford Ford is good. I'm not sure how we're going to qualify. We really worked hard on race stuff, and we got a good race car. I'm pretty excited. We've had, I think, 4 second place finishes here, so looking forward to this place. I mean, this is probably one of my favorite racetracks. A little hot today, a little slick, but qualifying, we're not sure. We got an awful good race car, though.
And just a reminder, guys, this is an impound race, so after they qualify, they won't be doing a whole lot of work to these cars to get race ready.
Yep. Make their couple laps here and put them under the cover for the night until tomorrow's race. Here is Ashton Lewis, who was pretty quick in practice earlier today. Sixth fastest earlier.
Lap looked pretty good, except for up in turn two, the car took a little bit of a slide, but it looked good getting in to the center. Pretty good lap.
Yeah. Third quick for Lewis, 27:237. A couple of ninth place finishes here for Lewis, his best. Best qualifying a second for the race in 2002. And the second lap for Ashton is going to be a little bit slower. And so third quickest out of 15 so far for Chesapeake, Virginia's Ashton Lewis. Lindsay, who are you talking to?
I'm talking to Tyler Walker. Tyler's fourth now. Why did you say you're a little bit frustrated with your performance out there?
I just tried to get a little bit aggressive. I wanted to go for a good lap and got in the gas just a little bit earlier than I did in practice. and the track's a little bit slicker. We went out real early when the Southwest Tour cars were on some different rubber than we were on and just got a little bit loose. Didn't have to lift all the way out, but just had to breathe it for a split second. And I think it probably hurt us about a tenth or two, and that's going to probably put us back a couple spots. But the Great Clips car was real good, and the Everham engine's running real strong. I felt like we had a real good car and race trim, and excited to be out here in this heat.
And he was out here in this heat 3 weeks ago in a Silver Crown car, so that might give him a slight advantage. Guys?
Laps.
Four laps.
J.J. Yaley's got a lot of laps here in open-wheel cars as well at Pikes Peak. He's on track now. Yaley with top 10 qualifying runs the last five straight races, and he just set the fast lap of the day.
There you go.
27.115 for J.J. Yaley, and he puts his Joe Gibbs Racing Chevy on top of the stack. One and done for Yaley. So new leader in Busch Pole qualifying. Yaley bumping David Green off the top of the stack. Many more cars still to come. Monday through Thursday nights at 7 on Speed, it's the all-new NASCAR Nation with Leanne Tweeden off track in depth and into the lives of NASCAR superstars like, say, Kenny Wallace. NASCAR Nation, life beyond the fast lane, Monday through Thursday, 7 Eastern on Speed. He's a sociable guy.
He wanted a microphone, but we don't have that much time.
Yeah. Here's Blake Fease on track, one of the Hendrick development drivers. I'll tell you what, it's got to be tough on these guys, Wally. They're basically getting to race about once a month.
Yeah, they're once a month, and they're in good equipment, so everybody expects results right away. And he's not getting them this week. I mean, it's a tough, like there again, like I said, it's tough to come to a place like this.
Blake, feel good about it.
Yeah,
Blake Fease, 16th out of 18 drivers, 28.114 so far for the Saybrook, Illinois native.
But, you know, he'll be in the race.
Yep.
And he'll get this experience, which is real important. And if he can keep his nose clean tomorrow and just stay out of the wrecks, he may get a very decent finish at it.
Second lap a little slower for Blake. We also mentioned that Shane Hall ran while we were away in the break, and Shane is 13th out of 18 so far. Lindsay.
I'm with J.J. Yaley, seeking your first career pole. How did that lap feel?
It should have been a lot better. The Vero Home Depot car was really good. A lot of guys were complaining of being loose, and I went through one and two really good, and I tried to cheat the throttle a little bit too much in three and four and got tight for a second. So I know we could have went at least a tenth better, but Jason Radcliffe's the smart one in the group. He told me to shut it down before I either stuck the thing in the fence or killed the tire. So far, good run. Hopefully it hangs in there for a top five, but definitely have to get my first pole.
Guys.
Lindsay, you making yourself at home there. You got your own soundtrack down there or something?
You
got the music, got the music playing, the whole thing?
Yeah, but I'm not going to dance.
No, okay.
All right.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Here's Stacy Compton. Talked to him just a minute ago. Very, very excited about coming here to Pikes Peak to race.
Yeah, he was pretty happy. Actually, he was happy to see Dave, which is unusual today because I'd much rather be interviewed by Lindsay. A lot of the drivers had that sour look on their face when Dave came
Dave
up
walks
to him.
Up.
But
yeah.
Oh, look out. Don't wreck that race car.
Oh, no, he's gonna.
Oh, you gotta hate that.
10th fastest on the first lap and into the wall on the second. And yeah, he's gonna be upset about that.
Wipe that smile right off his face.
Yes, sir.
That's not fun.
So Stacy Compton has caught the wall and brought out the red flag in our Busch Pole qualifying.
Right there at that patch, wasn't it?
What a lot of the guys talked about last year, Wally, and been talking about today. I know you've heard this from them as well. You hit that patch and you've got a lot of grip. No grip.
It takes tires off the racetrack.
No grip into the corner, hit the patch, have grip, get off the patch, no grip, and
yeah.
There you go. So Stacy Compton has crashed on his second qualifying lap here at Pikes Peak, and the red flag is out. RaceFan Speed Channel is putting you in the director's chair. Sign up for the Speed Onboard Pass and take control of the race. If you're a fan of ALMS, Grand Am, ARCA, or IROC, then you need to get Speed Onboard Pass now for only $4.99 per race. You get multiple race cameras streaming live, plus live timing and scoring and exclusive live pit-to-car audio.
And Speed Onboard Pass lets you chat with fellow race fans all while the race is going on. Speed Onboard Pass, log on to speedtv.com now and sign up. Red flag is out. You mentioned we didn't have time before.
Yeah, we do.
We now have time to talk to Kenny Wallace. Good. Lindsay?
Do we have time to hear him laugh? Because this guy's all smiles down here. Kenny Wallace currently holding third. What's up?
Well, first of all, I want to welcome you to Pit Road. But I'm so happy. Look at my smile. The world's largest RV retailer, Freedom Roads, is on my car. You know, we got this sponsor and Freedom Roads. I'm like, what is that? World's largest RV retailer. I mean, like $1 billion in a year they do. So I want to thank them for being on Bear Creek. You know, I just need a moment to do this because last week, a couple weeks ago, I didn't have a sponsor. My sponsor left me. But, hey, you're going to stay here full time, right, in the Busch Series now?
We'll see about that. But tell me about your RV. I mean, you're pretty excited about that, obviously.
Well, you know, what happens is we lost our sponsor. And right in the middle of the year, and it didn't help. But we're fifth in the points, and the car's running real good. And we're just all excited. You know what I mean? Because my guy's like, oh, Herm, man, I got to wear uniforms, and we don't feel like a heel right now. I said, boys, give me a couple weeks. I'm going to get you some uniforms and get you some money, and we'll win our first race of the year. You know, 3 second place finishes of the year. I feel like the bridesmaid. I feel like handsome hair again.
The bridesmaid.
You laughed. I made you laugh. Hey, she went, ha!
You might be the bride today, right?
Exactly. I love my wife, Kim. She's back there in the motorhome. they tell me I got to quit talking.
Kenny, I mean, is there anyone else here, like the fans, that you want to thank for anything?
Yeah, I want to thank this guy right here. Hey, this is Keith Barnwell. He's been working day and night on sponsorship. Keith, how did we get Freedom Road RV on this car?
Our good friends at Bear Creek helped us out with this. And we're very appreciative for what they've done for us.
And stay tuned for more exciting sponsors to come. Wait till St. Louis. The Wallace Family Tribute 2 video. The car is so awesome looking. I've already seen it.
Kenny, good luck.
Thank you, sweetheart.
All right, you're welcome.
She's the best.
All right, guys, see if you can top that.
Yeah. Good luck. Scott Lagacy Jr. has qualified 14th out of 20. The youngster, second-generation driver from St. Augustine, Florida.
I told you when they see Lindsay, they're all happy when they see. Nobody said, hey, Dave, are you here all year?
Yeah, not yet. Not yet. We'll give him a chance. He's probably working on that right now. He's going to have a cue card set up or something. Good to see Scott race his way into the show, although the team had points. He's in. Here's a driver who has to qualify on time. Tim Sauter looking for his second Pikes Peak Busch Series start. 2002, the last time he ran here, qualified 21st, finished 23rd. Now there are 47 drivers for the 43 starting spots, so four guys are going to go home. So if you're somebody like Tim with no guaranteed starting spot, you've got to beat four of those other drivers.
Yeah.
Who don't have points.
And he practiced pretty good, so I think he's going to be safe. But still, that's a lot of pressure. You go out there, you know if you make one mistake that you're going to go home.
How'd he do? He has qualified 14th right now, 27.694. And everyone who's qualified so far that doesn't have the guaranteed spot, he has been faster than. So he's beaten three others.
The bad thing is if you go out and practice decent, and then you can't back it up in qualifying.
Yeah.
That's what's really, I wouldn't know anything about that, but I know my hair is tough.
Second lap a little slower for Tim Sauter, and he will be 14th out of 21 so far. All right, let's see if someone's happy to see Dave. What do you think, Dave?
Well, we'll find out. I know Paul Menard's happy to be here. I don't know if he's happy to see me or not, but 10th on the board this morning, Paul. What kind of a qualifying car do you have, do you think?
I was wishing for a top 10. We concentrated on race runs, ran 70 laps on our tires, and got it handled pretty good. We came a long ways from where we unloaded. As a brand new race car, and Dan Stillman and the boys had their work cut out for them. So, real good race car, though. I'm happy with it. We got John's Manville on our hood. They're just up the road in Denver, so looking for a good showing for them.
Very good. And I swear, when I walked up to him, he said, hey, I'm glad you're here. I swear.
Thanks, Pinocchio.
Yeah. Here's Jennifer Cobb, looking to make her second NASCAR Busch Series start. Made the field for the season finale last year, Homestead Miami Speedway. Driving instructor for the Richard Petty Driving Experience, among other things. Second generation racer. And one of those who has no points has to beat four others to get into the field. Right now, not gonna do it. And that's gonna be even worse.
On. Okay, hit the gas.
Now, up the wall. No.
28.351 on the first lap. That was 22nd out of 22. And lap number two ended up like that. So Jennifer will not be in Saturday's race.
Just no grip.
I don't care how much you've done it or how much you prepare for it. The feeling when that car pops the wall like that's just got to be shocking. You just got to be, I can't believe I did that.
Yeah, it's just you feel bad because you just wrecked a race car and you're not in the race. That's really what's shocking.
Second red flag. In Busch Pole qualifying, we're back to Pikes Peak in a minute. Sunday night on Speed, Dave DeSpain welcomes Beth Ann Morgenthau to Wind Tunnel. Ms. Morgenthau, of course, owner of BAM Racing, Kenny Schrader's team in the Nextel Cup Series, sharing her thoughts about the role of women in motorsports, from ownership to drivers and crew members. Wind Tunnel, Sunday night, 9 Eastern on Speed. And the red flag continues here at Pikes Peak International Raceway after Jennifer Cobb crashed on her qualifying lap. We go back to the garage with Lindsay.
I'm standing beside Stacy Compton. Stacy, you were 10th quickest on your first lap, and then you crashed into the wall. What happened?
It's a little hotter than it was earlier this morning. This morning we were second quick. We got a great race car. Kingsford Ford is good. They're going to fix the car. It's mostly cosmetic. I don't think we've been to rear clip. We just got across the patch over here, and as soon as it come off the patch, there's a little bit more grip on that new asphalt. And as soon as we come across it, it snapped loose. But we'll get it fixed, get it back out there. We got an awful good race car, so we'll be okay.
And last year, you know, you finished this race second. So how difficult is it going to be for you starting from the back to get up to the front again?
Well, this is a tough place to pass. But still yet, if you've got a good race car, which we worked all day on race setups, and we feel like we've got a great race car. So, it'll be tough. We need the cautions to fall our way to get a little track position. But, I think we'll be okay. And on the flip side, we did get a new set of tires out of it. But my owner, I don't think he wants to hear that. But, I think it's going to be a little bit tough. But we'll be okay. We got off a good race car.
Dave, who do you have?
I'm with Bill Elliott, who is driving Rusty Wallace's number 64 here for the third time this year. And I think I need to have you answer that question again. Did he have to twist your arm to drive this car this year?
He might have had to break it. The way it worked out with Jamie and Jeremy driving the car most of the time, and then the way these three races fail, Nashville, Milwaukee, and here, it's just logistically hard for those guys to get back and forth. You got to give up something. And, Nashville, I didn't feel like we were very good at all, but Milwaukee, toward the end of the race, we got running real well, and here we're not bad. But, it takes a bit of time to work with the guys. I'd never worked with Blake and most of Rusty's guys here, and just trying to get a feel of what this top black car wants.
And of course, you've done mostly race runs, this being an impound race. How is it in that setup?
Well, I've never run here before. It's another racetrack. I told these guys, I'd like to go somewhere where I've raced before. I said, it'd be pretty nice. But
you saved your last races for all these new places, right?
Exactly. For some reason, I don't know why I had to be so goofy. But anyway, I think we're okay. But still, having the experience of running here and where these guys have got it on you, they can tweak a little bit to get started right off the bat to where we'll probably have to work through a little bit in the race.
That is the Bill Elliott in line to qualify, guys.
Tell you how little Bill knew about this racetrack. I saw him in the hotel restaurant on Thursday night. He asked me about the racetrack. Wow, you're off base there, pal. This track is on.
You're better off asking the cook at the restaurant.
I was trying to tee you up there, and you hesitated. You feeling okay?
Yeah, no, I'm good.
All right, thanks. Johnny qualified fourth here last year, but led 34 laps and then dropped out with an engine failure. Kind of feels like has one coming back to him here. And has one on the books. The fastest lap for Johnny Sauter. 27 flat.
I think I just park it now.
I think he got the message.
Yeah.
Screw Chief Joe Shear Jr. calling out saying, okay, that's enough. So Johnny Sauter won a couple of weeks ago at the Milwaukee Mile and has just bumped J.J. Yealy off the top spot. Randy DeJoy getting ready to make his qualifying run. Back at Pikes Peak International Raceway. Good run for Brent Sherman.
Very good run. They're quick.
27-14. So the St. Paul, Minnesota native
solidly into the field with a good starting spot for Saturday's race. Here's Randy McDonald in the 71 car. No points for Randy. Got to beat at least four of the other non-guaranteed drivers. By the way, when Jennifer Cobb crashed, that bumped Tim Sauter into the field for Saturday's race. And so McDonald has to at least beat Shane Hall's 18th fastest time at this point of a 27.795. Survey says, not quite close. 5 thousandths of a second or so. 8 thousandths of a second.
That hurts.
27.795 he has to beat.
He's going to be thinking about that when he sees the board when he's done.
Yeah.
Where he could have picked that up.
First,
don't think he's going to pick it up on the second lap.
No. Everybody's been giving up 2/10 or so on the second lap. Well, he picked it up. Thank you, Wallace.
Right again.
Expert opinion there. 27.746 for Randy McDonald, and he does jump ahead of Shane Hall. And McDonald bumps himself into the field.
Very good.
For Saturday's race.
That's nice. The first guy that's got quick on the second lap, I think.
Nice job, Randy. Lindsay.
I'm with Johnny Sauter. Johnny, currently you hold the pole. Is your car good enough to stay up front?
I hope so. That's what we worked on all day, and it was race runs and crazy race fans. But car's really good. Yellow Transportation guys did a good job, and never made it my qualifying run, so I'm pretty stoked about being able to run as fast as we did. Just worked that race runs. We put 64 laps on a set of tires today and just kept working on it, So it's all good.
And you're going for your third consecutive top 10, correct?
I think so. I'm not sure. You know more about it.
Come on, man.
I do it 1 week at a time. We just need to sit on the pole, lead the most laps, and try and win races because points at this point are out of the question. So we'll just keep doing it.
All right, Johnny. Thanks. Good luck. Guys.
So she's got the music, and now she's got the screamers down there, too. Here's Jerry Robertson, Arvada, Colorado, Denver area. Jerry, former regional champion in the NASCAR Dodge Weekly Racing Series.
Jerry is, looks like he's in a sprint car right now. I'll tell you what, he's driving the heck out of it, but that car is just looks scary.
14th fastest on his first lap, and wow, he was in a four-wheel slide there.
Driving for everything it's worth.
Driving for a spot in the race, and he's got one. So Jerry Robertson races his way into the field for Saturday's event at a 27.602. Dave is with a former Busch Series champion.
And he was 16th on the board earlier today. Let me ask about this track, Randy. You've been here 5 other times. Has it changed over time?
You know, this racetrack reminds me a lot of Darlington and Rockingham. The racetrack really kills your tires. Feels great for a couple laps, and then you start slipping and sliding. Now a jungle car, I've had it loose, I've had it tight, and made a mock-up run. I think I can get the thing in the top 10. We got a pretty good race car.
All right, keep your eye on the track. Obviously, it's changed.
Track temperature cooling off just a couple of degrees. We checked it just a minute ago. Here's Paul Menard. Heard from him earlier. This young kid's been on a roll here lately.
Looks like he pegged 1 and 2 pretty good on that lap.
And Menard in practice, 10th fastest. Time to beat 27.026. What'll it be? It'll be 2nd fastest.
Yeah. Very close. The cars that are going fast, they just look like they're pinned in the front. And you can just tell they're digging through the corners. You see a lot of other cars are just floating all over the racetrack. Looks like somebody's just standing on the hood of this car.
9th or better the last 5 straight races for Paul Menard. Says a little bit of improvement in the cars, a little improvement in the crew, and a little improvement in me is what's getting it done. 2nd fastest on the day for Paul Menard in search of his first NASCAR Busch Series win tomorrow. 27 of 47 drivers have made their Busch Pole qualifying runs. More when we come back to Pikes Peak. In Saturday's race, 24th fastest out of 28. He did bump Shane Hall into the field, and Quarterly unsuccessful in his qualifying attempt. Here's somebody we're expecting a pretty speedy time out of. Aaron Fike on the track now.
Yep, got through 1 and 2 pretty good. Slid a little bit right there, but Aaron was 4th fastest in the final practice.
Hattiesburg, Illinois, 22-year-old driver, sharing time in this car with Greg Biffle this year. And a fifth fastest lap on his first trip around.
I think he'll be happy with that.
His only trip around. 27-2-1-3, fifth out of 29 for Aaron Fike, who also has some USAC open wheel experience here at Pikes Peak. All right, Lindsay, let's see what happens this time.
Brent Sherman's best start so far this season came in Phoenix in April. He was 15th. Is it something about hot tracks? Because right now you're holding on to four.
I don't know what it is. I guess it's all the team, I have to say. I mean, PPC just gave me a great race car all day today. And, it's nice to run up front, and hopefully we can have our best start here today. Hopefully we'll stay in the top 10. Car was a little free, I'm not greedy. As long as we can build on this every week and have better runs every week, I'm just extremely happy. If we would have pushed it a little bit more or tightened it up just a touch, maybe we would have had a shot at the pole, but I'm not going to get greedy yet.
All right. Good luck, Fred.
Thank you.
Guys.
All right, here's Kevin Hamlin, two-time NASCAR Northwest Tour champion, looking to make his NASCAR Busch Series debut this weekend.
And he struggled a little bit in that last practice. We're 42nd fastest.
I wonder how many times he's had to answer the question about any relation to the Nextel Cup crew chief.
Probably quite a bit. So yeah. That's a pretty good lap right there.
16th fastest for Kevin, 27:44, and that's it. Snohomish, Washington, his hometown. Ran a couple ARCA races for Ken Schrader Racing earlier this year, and now at the Ganassi Driver Development Program, going to take a shot behind the wheel of the Geico machine in tomorrow's race. 30 of 47 drivers have run. Randy LaJoie getting ready to go. Martin Truex Jr. and Bill Elliott still to come from Pikes Peak. Nice job, Eric McClure, as we come back to Pikes Peak International Raceway. Raced his way into the field after not getting a whole lot of practice time today. Had an engine problem this morning, spent most of the practice time changing engines in that machine, Jimmy Means and his crew, but Eric needing to get into the field on time, qualifying 20th out of 31 drivers. Tip the hat to him.
It's such a relief when you know you've got to get in that way.
Yeah.
And you make it.
Here is Mark Green. Also not guaranteed a spot in the field on point, so has to beat at least four of the drivers, and he'll do that handily. Mark, 17th fastest on that first lap. 27:451 for Mark. And sounds like he got the word. We'll be all done.
Usually you're told when you're getting outside of off of turn two is usually when they come over the radio and say, okay, that's enough.
Good enough. All right. Bill Elliott in a moment. First, Lindsay with Paul Menard.
Long 3 minutes.
Paul Menard just says that's a long 3 minutes to wait, but you'll be pretty excited if you hold on to that second place spot, right? How was the lap out there?
Slippery. This track, the track's awesome because it's so slippery. You don't really have a good handling race car. Just one big controlled slide, basically. But the reason I said 3 minutes, I'm standing out here in a black suit, so it's a little warm. Real happy, though. I mean, second place, hopefully it holds up to be a top five, if not top 10. And I know we got a good race car tomorrow.
Is any advantage in this weather?
No, it's just hot and slippery. That's it.
All right, good luck, Paul.
It's gone around for Paul Menard lately. Here's Bill Elliott. His 40th NASCAR Busch Series start will be tomorrow's race. Practice, as far as Bill's concerned, the seventh fastest. What's it going to be here?
Second fastest.
How about that?
Yes.
27:031 for Bill. And done.
Oh, yeah.
One NASCAR Busch Series win for Bill. You remember when it was?
No.
Watkins Glen.
Really?
Yep. Went up there and just absolutely stomped the field one day. Led about the whole race from start to finish. Bill, looking for win number two tomorrow would be certainly popular with the fans out here in Colorado. Remember, he drove for Coors for so many years based out here in Golden. Dave, who you got?
Tony Raines getting ready to go out and qualify. The last time we saw you, kind of a tough end to last week, a little anger management going on there. Did you talk to your car owner this week about that? What did Kevin Harvick have to say?
Well, he thought maybe I lost my grip, but it was a bad day at the office for me and the whole Outdoor Channel.
Chevrolet, but, you know, he really couldn't say much. It'd be like the pot calling the kettle black, but we'll do better this weekend.
How are you doing this weekend? How's your car?
We were fair. I messed up my mock run. We were like 19th in practice, so we're looking for a little better in that qualifying.
Okay, Tony's about six cars back. Get ready to go, guys.
Anger management. What a great phrase for this sport, isn't it?
It's used often, or maybe misused.
Yeah. Steve Grissom, 27th fastest out of 34 on his first lap. Steve needing to race his way in. Two, three, four. He has done so. He will be good to go on Saturday. Of course, Steve has that former champion provisional available to him, but a 27.83 for Steve Grissom, and a 27th out of 34. He is in the field for Saturday's race. Well, Tony Raines, Casey Atwood, Clint Bowyer, Martin Truex, still to come. We'll talk to Bill Elliott when we come back to Pike Speed. You are looking at Kim Crosby, who has just raced her way into the field for tomorrow afternoon's 250-miler. Was out of a qualified spot on her first lap, and Wally picked up enough time on the second lap to slide on into the grid.
That was well said, Alan. Yes, that was impressive, picking up on the second lap. Now, she probably got the word on the radio that it wasn't quick enough and
raced her way in. Great job, Stanton Barrett and this team last Saturday at New Hampshire.
Yeah, they did a good job.
Pick up their first top 10 finish of the season.
Yep. You know, while these guys are jet setting a lot of times back and forth across the country in their own jets, this guy does it commercially.
Yeah.
What was it? Milwaukee and California, was it? Sears Point? Was he running the
Stanton?
Yeah, cup race. And there's two races I remember.
Hey, look at this. Sixth fastest.
There you go.
Well, he's got some good people working with him. You know, Ricky Pearson.
Yeah, he's been around a long time.
Been there, done that, knows how to win these races. New team owners, the McGills out of Cleveland. But they're getting their sea legs under them. And they're starting to put it together. Sixth fastest for Stuntman Stan.
Very good.
27.206. Nice job. Bill Elliott is with Lindsay.
And he's with a ton of fans that are here crowded around screaming out to see him. Bill, you were asking what it's like to race this track. You obviously seem like you know it very, very well. How was it out there?
Good. You know, the Blake and all the guys did a real good job of bringing the car here. And, you know, it's different when you got a pretty good race car and you come to a place. You know, it reminds me of somewhere, but I can't think of the racetrack it reminds me of. But it looks like it's going to be a lot of fun to race, and hopefully we can have a good day tomorrow.
You still have fun out here with all the fans as well?
Oh, this is a ball. I mean, this is a place you normally don't get to, so it's good to see the fans that you normally can't get to.
Awesome, Bill. Second fastest so far. Here is Reagan Smith.
Does he have points, or is he another one of those guys that got a...
His is kind of an interesting situation, Wally. They didn't send the entry blank in for the race before the entry deadline.
Doesn't matter.
So, yes, it does. So they would have been in position to potentially get in on points, but because they are a post-entry, they're not eligible for that spot. So they have to race their way in.
What I mean, it doesn't matter because he's 14th fastest.
Okay, I'm with you now. Slight failure to communicate there.
I know you're right in the middle of it. I was looking at the screen going, oh, okay. Go ahead, finish up.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. Second lap up to ninth.
Well,
even especially now,
yeah,
doesn't matter.
Doesn't really matter.
Dave, is what you're going to do matter?
It matters a lot because I'm with the guy who's second in the championship, trying to chase down that 8 car. And you know, you might have had a really good shot at it with one of your favorite cars, but that's not the one you're running this weekend, right?
Yeah, old Betsy, we tore her up a little bit last week, trying to make something out of nothing, and knocked fenders in a little bit, but she's home in the hospital, men, and they're taking care of it, and she'll be back out. But got a good race car to run California. I think we finished fourth in this car out in California, so good race car. Finished fourth here last year, so it's a neat racetrack. It's racy, and you know, it's my kind of track. I like it.
What does your mock qualifying run tell you about the laps you're about to take?
We were real tight in our mock qualifying run, and you know, just real conservative because we chased the car for 50 laps and finally got it where we wanted. And you know, you're always scared to put full fuel and put tires on it right there. So look real conservative on mock qualifying run, but I think we'll be fine right here.
That's Clint Bowyer in the Blue Deuce, guys.
Getting ready to go. John Hayden, Owensboro, Kentucky.
needing to race his way in. He has done it.
I wonder if this track temperature is coming down a little bit. A little more, just a couple degrees more than the couple degrees it had when we checked it last.
We'll get our people on that.
Yeah, let's get our first person on that. Do we have one?
Yeah. John Hayden is a mechanic for Bruco Racing. He works on David Green's cars. Has not run a NASCAR Busch Series race since this race 1 year ago. Talked with him this morning. Getting back together with this team that he drove for in 2003 to run this race and the next few. And he's put it into the field very solidly. 16th fastest for John. Very nice. Aaron Fike, 7th fastest so far. Lindsay.
Aaron Fike won an Infiniti Pro race here a couple years back. Aaron, right now you're sitting 7th, like they said. How does it feel to race in this kind of car?
Great. New Moore and all the guys at Bruco give me a great car. And I think I left a little bit on the table. And I lost a little bit down in 3 and 4. We were 4th in practice. And I think we should have ended up a little bit better. But I think with the heat and where we went out, it's not bad, but I think we could have been a little bit better. But I got to thank all the guys at Bruco Motorsports, Clarence Brewer, Todd Wilkerson, for giving me the chance to run Greg Biffle's machine pretty much, and everyone else.
What's it going to take for you to get up front tomorrow?
I don't know. Just being consistent. It seems like tires fall off really quick here, and being more consistent than anyone else, obviously with faster lap times. But we seem to be pretty fast on 50-lap tires today, so I think we got a pretty good shot for tomorrow.
To Dave.
Well, Lindsay, I've pretty much figured out following Wally's lead there that everyone's pretty excited to talk to you today. And to me, well, they're just sort of indifferent. But I did find a heat gun, Wally, that would speak to me about track temperature.
Okay.
124. So it is coming down.
It's dropped quite a bit. That's a lot. And right now, as it's dropping, that's going to help all these guys at the end, especially 2X. he'll take advantage of it.
This guy who really doesn't need a lot of help the way he's been running lately. By the way, Jeff Fuller racing his way into the field, 22nd fastest out of 39. Martin Truex Jr. What can you say about his last five or so races? On a tear. Picking up the win in New Hampshire last week after pitting four times in a 200-lap race. It's kind of unheard of.
That looked good so far. Looked real good.
Killed it off the wall. And the car turned real good. You got a very late entrance, which is, looks like what you need here if you have grip. That's hard to do without the grip, but it's like a pretty good lap. In practice, Truex was 11th fastest. What's it going to be here? It's going to be pretty good. Not good enough.
I'll take that.
Not going to get in the pole, but we'll get him fourth spot. 27.098 for Martin Truex, led 152 of 250 laps in this race last year, lost out on strategy. Greg Biffle and Stacy Compton saved a set of tires for the end of the race and put them on and ran to the front.
And they're all going to be looking at doing that tomorrow.
Yeah.
Because that's what everybody's talking about, is whoever has the best set of tires at the end of the race is going to be the guy to beat.
So the NASCAR Busch Series championship leader will go to the garage with the outside row two starting spot for Saturday's race. And now on the clock, Casey Atwood, green flag, and the Ray Evernham Motorsports machine. Casey in the middle of a little string of races in this car.
A little bit of a wiggle, not too bad.
It's kind of... Struggle would be the word I'd use to describe the races that Casey's had so far this year. Best finish of 9th at Kentucky. And really hoping for a lot more. As I'm sure is Ray.
It's a pretty good lap right there.
Yes, it is. 4th fastest for Casey Atwood. Great qualifying run. And Casey will be much closer to the front than the last couple of weeks with the green flag waves.
I think this track cooling down a little bit, Alan, is making a big difference for some of these guys, too.
6 cars to go. Got LaJoy pictured there, then Tony Raines, Clint Bowyer, Jason Keller, Curtis Davis, and A.J. Fike, Aaron's brother, will be the last of the 47 drivers to run.
Randy. Yep. Randy was fairly happy with this car when I talked to him down there earlier. He's pretty optimistic.
Randy, last raced here at Pikes Peak in 2002. Best qualifying here, eighth. Best finish, third. Raced back in 1998. And this is a brand new team that just kind of took some time at the beginning of this year to get its legs underneath it.
Well, they got the right guy in there for a new team. Randy's got a lot of experience. Very good with these race cars, so.
Hey, pretty sporty, too.
Yeah, eighth quick. He was, like I said, he was pretty happy about it.
27-14 for Randy. Sounds like he's going to go for two. 43 years old, Norwalk, Connecticut, looking to make his 337th NASCAR Busch Series start. If this holds up, it's going to be Randy's best start of the season. 12th in Milwaukee was his best previous. So eighth fastest for
Randy.
And five cars to go. Here's the anger management man from last Saturday in New Hampshire anyway. Tony Raines.
We had a lot of that last weekend.
You know, I was talking to somebody during the week about that, Wally. Both races, Saturday and Sunday, I heard more drivers ticked off at other drivers on the scanner early in the race than normal. Normally, you know, you get down to those last 50, 75 laps, things get a little intense and the tempers come up. There's like lap 25.
Well, the reason I think is because at New Hampshire, it's so hard to pass. And you could be faster than a guy and you just can't get around him. And I mean, you'll sit there and follow that for two or three laps and then you just get madder and madder and then your temper gets, you know, it just starts boiling. So it's just a tough place to pass. Where Bristol, the place that you think that's where you get in a lot at Bristol.
Yeah.
Bristol, you can get into a guy a little bit, knock him out of the way, and not really wreck him.
Yeah.
Unlike New Hampshire, get into a guy a little bit there, and he's going to wreck.
Pretty good lap for Tony. 27-17, going to get him ninth spot out of 43. And Tony Raines very solidly in the field. Now fifth fastest for Martin Truex, Lindsay.
Martin Truex just walked up to me with his head shaking. What's wrong?
I left a pole in the car out on the track somewhere. Just disappointed, but it's a good qualifying effort for us. Really want to get a pole this year. One of these days we're going to get it, but this impound deal, just, I don't know, not good qualifying with it.
Well, last week you started seventh. You went on to win at New Hampshire. Can you do that same thing here?
I think so, yeah. We made some changes to our car after practice, and they worked really good. Actually, I ended up being a little bit too tight, a little tighter than I wanted to be, and that really hurt me. But the cars, I really feel good about it. We'll just have to see. You know, it's going to be a long race, and as long as we're around at the end, we'll be able to do something with them, I think.
Dave?
Well, right now, back in the garage area, looking at the 59 car of Stacy Compton. We're actually going to talk to Chris Rice, his crew chief. Chris, NASCAR is letting you guys work on a car here that has technically been impounded, but you're going to pay a little penalty for that, aren't you?
Yeah, we're going to have to go to the rear. You know, they won't let us change springs or nothing like that, but they're generous enough to let us fix this mangled up Kingsford car. But, you know, the guys are doing a really good job with it. Everybody back at the shop has done a good job all year. We've just had a lot of bad luck this year. You know, it's been a bad year for luck for us, but, you know, we're going to turn around here. We got a good race car. We knew we weren't going to be the best in the world qualifying, but we got a really good race car. And, you know, 2003 here, I got a win, and we passed a lot of cars that year. So hopefully we can do it again tomorrow.
Okay, well, Chris, go back to work with his guys there. NASCAR is going to let them stay here until the end of qualifying to work on this. And then they'll probably let them in maybe a little bit early tomorrow morning. They're still discussing that. But as he said, this car will have to start in the rear. Alan?
I'm going to make a prediction. We're going to be talking to Clint here in just a second.
You could be right.
Clint Bowyer, fast lap of the day so far. 26.944, first driver under 27 seconds. And three cars to go. Jason Keller, pole winner here for the race in 2002. First lap going to be 28th. For Jason, 27.557. And for Jason Keller, he's got three top five finishes here at Pikes Peak in the last 4 years.
It's pretty good.
Yep.
Pretty good record.
Yep. And they've had an okay season.
Yeah, it's been okay. I think they were expecting a lot better go of it, but they have struggled early. So then they started showing a little consistency.
So they'd like to pull one of those top five finishes out here and kind of get a little momentum going.
More cutout.
Second lap, just a touch faster, 27th fastest for Jason Keller. And then there were two cars to go. It was Curtis Davis. On track, Gaffney, South Carolina driver, 24-year-old. His first NASCAR Busch Series start here at Pikes Peak. Best finishes this year for this team have come on the restricted plate tracks. And Curtis looking to make his 30th NASCAR Busch Series start. He does have to race his way in.
He had a pretty good practice earlier today. He was, what was he, about 19th or 20th? 20th.
Has to be faster than Brad Teague, the 40th place car.
Ooh, on the limiter hard.
And it's going to be a lot faster than that 40th place car. How about 11th for Curtis Davis?
Good run.
Cool track temperature, decent car like you were talking about.
Yep. It all makes a big difference.
Yep. Nice job. Curtis Davis, 11th out of 46. And now the final car. Getting ready to come onto the track, and that's going to be A.J. Fike. Now, yes, we had Aaron Fike out earlier. A.J. is his older brother. Same background, USAC open wheel cars. He's run here several times in the midgets and sprints and so on. And yes, the A.J. is named after that A.J.
And yes, he wants to beat his brother.
But it's not Anthony Joseph. It's Anthony James. He said his mom didn't like Joseph. AJ needing to race his way into this field.
Where was he in practice?
35th. If he can back that up, he's good. He'll be good to go if he can back that up.
You mean these guys don't have enough points to get in?
Nope. Really? Don't win all the races. Check it out for AJ Fike at the line. He's good. 27-71, 35th. For A.J. Fike, exactly where he practiced.
Getting the word. Okay, you can come in. Kerry didn't give us the word.
Kerry
Agajanian,
team owner.
So Kerry may not be here yet.
Yeah, okay. Fifth start of the year, fifth start of his Busch Series career for A.J. Fike. And he'll move up to 31st on his second lap. And A.J. Fike will join his brother in the field for tomorrow's race. So Busch pole qualifying is over. Clint Bowyer has won pole position, his first of the season. We talk to him when we come back to Pikes Peak International Raceway. Next on Speed, the Trackside Gang fires it up at Pocono. No telling what will happen this time around with Rusty Wallace in the mix. And, of course, you never know who's going to stop by for a visit. Trackside Live from Pocono next, only on Speed. Drivers continuing to sign away for the fans gathered here at Pikes Peak International Raceway. Clint Boyer's not signing right now, though. He's ready to talk with Lindsay.
Clint Bowyer, your pole sitter right ahead of Johnny Sauter. You said the two of you were joking around before you raced today. What happened?
Yeah, he asked me if I was going to hold up, and I was just kind of joking around. I thought I told him he'd be, you know, close to a top five or something like that. I didn't think he'd be the one I'd have to beat for the pole, but, you know, Gil and all the guys have been working really hard on this AC Delco Chevrolet, really proud of what they've done. I think that's three out of the last four poles for our Busch shop, so, you know, it says a lot for what the organization's got going on in our Busch teams.
And you really like this racetrack, you said.
Yeah, it's a neat racetrack. It's wide. It's a, you know, it's a racy racetrack. You can move around a little bit if your car's not working on the bottom. You can move up. You can pass. You know, you can search around and find a place you need to run. So really looking forward to tomorrow. Like I say, the mock qualifying run, we were real tight and wasn't sure what we were going to have. Gil made some changes on the car, and I think they're going to, you know, go on and be a plus for tomorrow as well. So really excited to get my first pole.
Congratulations, Clint. And he hasn't held a pole, by the way, since last year at Talladega. So you said this is your first real pole. Congratulations.
Thank you.
So Clint Bowyer keeps the streak alive here at Pikes Peak. Eight races, eight different pole winners.
That's amazing.
Yep.
And amazing.
We look at the starting lineup for tomorrow's 250 miler.
Bill Elliott there inside row two. That should be fun to watch.
Martin Truex qualifying well. Stan Barrett trying to back up his top 10 for New Hampshire.
We got Stacy Compton back there in row 12. Got a lot of work to do on that 59 car.
And of course, he'll have to drop to the back because of the adjustments after the impound that they're making to his car. Like, oh, I don't know, a new right rear quarter panel, a new deck lid. And don't forget, Carl Edwards will be dropping to the back of the field and starting scratch tomorrow when he arrives from Pocono as well. Clint Bowyer, the Bud Pole winner, excuse me, the Busch Pole Award winner here at Pikes Peak today.
Back at Pikes Peak International Raceway, where Clint Bowyer is the pole sitter, but another guy who is extremely happy about his qualifying run is Curtis Davis, a career best 11th. A lot of people don't know, though, you had a tough day getting there.
Yeah, I had a real tough day. You know, we only made about probably 15 laps total in practice. We broke a motor 5 laps into practice here at
Where are we? Pikes Peak, I think, right?
Yeah, we're at Pikes Peak. I was about to say Phoenix there for a minute, but I tell you what, we got 3 crew members on this team, including myself, and we work extremely hard, you know, and I got to thank my dad for this opportunity and Race Girls, Sequoia Express, and people just don't know how much work we go through to get here each and every week, but this is a dream come true. You know, we got a good qualifying effort, and hopefully we can back that up with a solid top 10 finish tomorrow.
Now, they won't have to do a lot of work from here, of course. We've talked about the fact that this is an impound race. Curtis's car has already been covered up. Tomorrow morning, they'll just be able to do a couple of things to get this thing ready. In fact, they'll be able to add no fuel. They can just change the shocks a little bit, pull tape off the nose, and Curtis and everyone else will be ready to go. We'll be back here to Pikes Peak International Raceway. That's where we are to wrap things up in just a moment.
In the shadow of majestic Pikes Peak, where Wally Dallenbach tried to race a car a couple of months ago.
I was like, guys, you can't take the shot away when I'm working on the telestrator.
Well, Busch Pole qualifying is over. Clint Bowyer's number atop the board. He'll lead the field to the green flag tomorrow. 250 miles on a hot day on this very slick one-mile track. Tire strategy is going to be big. It's going to be an interesting day, I think.
I think you're right, and I think it is tire strategy. That's what it's going to come down to, who's got the best set of tires at the end of the day.
Brandon Miller getting a shot in the Richard Childress 21. Kenny Wallace, he didn't have much to say during qualifying. Stacy Compton will have to go to the back with a repaired car. And, of course, we'll have Carl Edwards coming from the back as well. Trackside live from Pocono coming up next for Wally, Dave Burns, and Lindsey Zardiac. Alan Bestwick saying so long from Pikes Peak International Raceway, where Clint Bowyer is your Busch Pole Award winner today.